Okay, welcome all of you. I'm going to talk about auditory filters today. But before I start that, I will say a little bit about myself. My name is Torben Poulsen, and I have been teaching and made research within those areas that you can see here, within psychoacoustics, acoustic communication, speech, and things like that. And I have also been involved in international standardization over the years. But okay, let's start the talk here about auditory filters. I will give you a short introduction, and then I will present a model of auditory filters and the frequency selectivity concept, something about the bandwidth of these auditory filters, and some examples. There will also be a listening demonstration before we come to the examples, and let's hope that it will work in the way we want it to be. There will also be something about hearing loss implications about these auditory filters and a few final remarks. The concept here is about, or the situation is about, many sounds heard at the same time. For example, an orchestra. You have an orchestra, some people are sitting there playing the different instruments, and it is, for us, easy to hear and identify different instruments also when they play at the same time. And we use our auditory filters for that. If we have two people talking, it's also easy to distinguish those two people from their voices, even if they talk at the same time. And as I said, how do we do this separation? We do it by means of our auditory filters. The auditory filters that we have in our hearing system, we use that to separate sound from various sound sources. The auditory filters are related to the movement of the basilar membrane. So it's something that happens out in our sensory system, mainly. What's a filter? When I say auditory filter, what's a filter? So let's just make a little talk about that. We have a filter there, as you can see here on the screen, low frequencies, high frequencies, and a filter here with some bandwidth, the width of the filter. And the idea with the filter is that when we have frequencies within the bandwidth of the filter, those frequencies will be passed through the filter. But outside the filter, those frequencies that lie outside the filter, they will not come through, so they will be stopped at the filter position. No, nothing there. That's the filter idea. Now I'm going to present this model. Now I've just talked about the filters, and we can think about having many filters that cover the whole auditory frequency range so that we understand all these things together, can hear all the frequencies that we are able to hear covered by a number of filters. The model is composed of these things that you can see on the screen. We have the sound coming into the ear, going into the auditory filters here, which could be such a number of filters that cover the whole frequency range. At the back of each filter, there will be a detector that looks for what's coming out of that filter. And this is something that takes place in the brain, what's coming out of the filter. And further up in the brain, all these outputs will be combined into a perception so that we can hear something. We can hear what's coming in from the left side here, and we get a perception out of that. This is a very coarse model. It's not in any way the correct model, but it's a good way of thinking about these auditory filters. It's much more complicated than this. We can try to find out how wide are these filters. And I'm trying to make a demonstration now about this. Remember, we have the bandwidth of a filter, and outside the filter there will be no signals coming through. How wide are the auditory filters? We will make a demonstration about a measurement at 2 kHz, at 2000 Hz. It's a very old demonstration. It's an old idea. Fletcher, an American researcher back in the 40s, it's almost 100 years ago now. It's almost, not necessarily, but almost. And we will determine the threshold of a pure tone. A pure tone, it's illustrated here by the red line, as a function of the bandwidth of a noise around the pure tone. So I'm going to put in, you have to listen for this pure tone, and then I will go to put in some noise around the pure tone, and you can try to listen for this. The noise is centered at the pure tone frequency. Okay, now let's try to see what happens.
Critical bands by masking. You will hear a 2000 Hz tone in 10 decreasing steps of 5 decibels. Count how many steps you can hear. Series are presented twice. Now the signal is masked with broadband noise. Next, the noise has a bandwidth of 1000 Hz. Next, noise with a bandwidth of 250 Hz is used. Finally, the bandwidth is reduced to only 10 Hz.
How many could you hear any difference? How many could you count? To begin with, you said something, or you made some notes at least.
Yeah. I sort of have 6 with the widest one, and then 9 with the narrowest.
With narrow ones, yes. Let's see the experiment, the result of this experiment from Fletcher's hand is this, that if you have a very wide noise, you will hear, yeah, you will, everything will be masked. And then when you go in and make it more and more narrow, then at the end you will be able to hear the threshold. You will come down to the threshold. So the idea here, and it's perhaps not the very best demonstration, but the idea here is to say that only things within that filter around the 2 kHz is important for the threshold of the 2 kHz tone. Everything that lies outside that, because they are outside the filter of the 2 kHz, will have no influence on this. And here, where it changed, going down here, this this corner will tell you the width of the auditory filter. And in this case, it's about 400 hertz. So at the frequency 2000 hertz, the bandwidth of the auditory filter is 400 hertz. And that bandwidth depends on the pure tone frequency. It's not so that that filter is just there and it's a fixed filter. It depends on the frequency that we are actually using for this demonstration. Now, there are many other ways of measuring these filters' bandwidth. And the results are that the filters are related to the movement of the basilar membrane, as I have said already. Auditory filters depend on the sound signal that you put in, and they are also influenced by the feedback mechanism in the auditory system. So we are actually able to make some feedback into adjusting the filters so that they are optimal for what we are trying to listen to. Here we have some measurements of the auditory filters, the bandwidth of all this. At low frequencies, narrow, the bandwidth is around 100 hertz or something less than that. If we are coming up to higher frequencies up here, then the bandwidth, of the filters are more wide. And a good approximation to all this could be bandwidth of a 1/3 octave filter. So a 1/3 octave filter bank is a reasonably good approximation to the auditory filters in our hearing system. Now some examples. We have all these filters that cover the whole frequency range. And I will show you here the spectrum of speech for male and female persons. The typical fundamental frequency for a male would be 125 hertz. 125 hertz, that's typically my fundamental frequency. When I say like that, then you could go in and analyze that, and it will be about 125 hertz. That will lie over there, 125 hertz. Now, if I look for some female, then their fundamental frequency would be 250 hertz. That's something one octave above the males. So that's the peak there. And you can see that the spectrum here at the low frequency end is a little bit different from males and females. But at the higher frequencies, the same spectrum. You will see the same spectrum for males and females for the upper frequencies. But the reason why we can hear a difference between males and females is our auditory filters. Those two fundamental frequencies and the upper harmonics will fall into different auditory filters. And that would say, okay, I'm listening to a male or I'm listening to a female. You can hear that just by detecting the fundamental frequency. Another example is that if you take a speech signal, say Eve or boot or father, then if you look at the spectrum of the vowels of these things, then there will be some peaks in the vowels. If I say E, then there will be some peaks here. And if I say boot, then there will be some other peaks. And father, then there will be some other peaks again. And these peaks are called formants. And those red arrows here, they indicate where these peaks are. And we use these peaks to detect the difference between Eve and boot and father. I'm convinced that you can hear a difference between Eve and Booth and father. And you do that by means of the peaks here. And those peaks are falling into different auditory filters, and then our brain will say, ah, now it's an oo, and now it's an ah, and now it's an e, just by detecting what's coming out of the filters there. So we use these formants to distinguish between vowels. They go into different auditory filters. So it's essential for our speech intelligibility that we can do this. If we have a hearing loss, then I have a picture here showing some of the normal ears, how a typical auditory filter would say would look like for a normal hearing person. But for an impaired, for a person with an impaired hearing, the filters may look like this. And this means that you have broader auditory filters. They are not that selective, they are not that sharp as for normal hearing persons. They are broader, and that means that you will have fewer filters to cover the whole frequency range because these are broader. That means that we will get a bad auditory resolution, and it will become difficult to separate sounds, and you will have a bad formant separation. If you have broader filters, then some of these formants that you saw on the picture here, some of these formants will fall into the same filter, and that makes it difficult for people with hearing loss to distinguish between the different vowels. So it's not just, if you have a hearing loss, it's not just a problem or a matter of hearing the things. It's also a matter of trying to analyze the signals coming into your brain and distinguish between the different vowels. Then some final remarks. Where are the auditory filters? And I think I have said that a few times now, that they are at the basilar membrane. Here we have the basilar membrane when you try to stretch it out and see how it works. For 6 kilohertz, you will have such a movement there that looks, if you look at the envelope of the movement, that looks similar to the shape of the auditory filters. So we have the auditory filters here at the basilar membrane. The shape is partly determined by the basilar membrane movement, but there's also the feedback mechanism in the auditory system that can go down and try to manipulate the filters to make them more sharp and better fitted for what they are doing. And just to remind you that all what I have said about the basilar membrane, that takes place down here at the cochlea, but there are a lot of nerve connections up to the brain where the perception is that can influence the way all these things are working. It's a very complex structure, and that means that the model that I started up with, saying that we have all these filters lying one by one up covering the whole frequency range, is a coarse model, but it's a more complicated situation in reality. Thank you.